Your comfy chair, grab a coffee, sit down and watch.
During the meanwhile.
Well, hello. That was a bit feeble, wasn't it? Well, hello. It's Dexter.
You notice a little stammer in that one.
Well, hello. It's Dexter and me back on YouTube with yet more Tech Tuesday tomfoolery. I did promise I'd stop singing, didn't I? Anyway. This week, I am rather lazily repeating the formula of a video from a couple of weeks ago where I gave you three reasons to buy a Fujifilm X-E1 in 2022. I'm going to repeat that because that video was such a resounding success that I'm still waiting for YouTube to deliver my award. Anyway, today I'm going to give you three reasons to buy a Nikon or Nikon. You say Nikon, I say Nikon. Let's call the whole thing off. Yes, let's actually. D90 camera in 2022. Right, I bought one of these back in 2012 when I graduated, pardon me, from a Nikon. D3100. I wanted a more pro looking and feeling body, and this is the one I went for, the D90. And I loved it. And buying one again now, and I'm going to pop up some old images that I shot with my first D90, has brought back some really, really nostalgic memories, obviously, because memories are nostalgic. Using it, hearing the shutter sound, and I'll play that for you later on, brought back so many happy memories of, you know, hiking to my destination at the ends of the day, you know, to get a nice image. And in particular, I documented waterfall country with this camera, and I'll come on to that a little bit later on as well. Anyway, why should you buy one of these in 2022? And here are my three reasons for you doing that. Reason number one is the fact that this is a really iconic camera. Now, it replaced Nikon's D80, you'd be surprised to know, with a slight megapixel or resolution bump from 10 to 12.2. But more importantly, this was the very first ever DSLR by any manufacturer to include video recording functionality, albeit only 720p, and I'll pop a little sample up now of some early video I recorded with it. So not even full HD, but all the same, video was present on this camera for the first time ever in the DSLR market. And I think for that video reason, amateur photographer in a recent article voted this one of Nikon's 12 most important DSLR cameras of all time. So if you do decide to buy one of these, you are buying a chunk of iconic history. You really are. Now, second reason, reason numero two, in common with most old cameras of this age, is its low price. It really is a bargain. Now, I got this one back in December last year from MPB here in the UK. I think I paid about £130 for it, there or thereabouts. And this is a near mint example, bar some scratching on the base plate, with fewer than 10,000 actuations on it. So a real bargain. You can get them cheaper, obviously, if you shop around or are prepared to take, you know, risks on, you know, eBay with a seller that you maybe don't know, or you don't know the condition of the camera. But I think if you've got a low shutter count example of one of these, you're not going to go far wrong. And I don't think you're going to lose any money either. I certainly think I could get my money back if I decided to sell this. And the third reason, and the most important one, because, you know, iconography and price aside, if it doesn't produce good pictures, then, you know, it's a useless camera. But it really is a very, very, still a very, very capable camera in 2022. The sensor is good in good light. I wouldn't really want to push the ISO past 3200, to be honest. But in good light, it produces really good, clear, you know, images. The ergonomics of the camera are excellent. It's got a lovely grip. And even with this hunk of a macro lens stuck on it, it's not that heavy or hard to hold. It's got a lovely top plate display. So it's more of, I mean, Nikon said this was like a consumer camera. I think it's more of a prosumer, to be honest. And even though they didn't directly replace this, the camera that kind of replaced it, if you like, was the D7000 range, and that was certainly a prosumer camera, albeit I think then with dual card slots this only has one. But the build of this, the top plate, it has a real sort of pro feel to it, and it's really easy to use. If you've used any Nikon DSLR, you'll use this within seconds. And to be honest, when I bought this, I was up and running within minutes. All the memories came flooding back, especially of the shutter, well, the mirror slap and the shutter sound. Well, they're probably best, isn't it? There we are. What a lovely, lovely sound that is. Very nostalgic. The lens mount is Nikon's F mount, so you've got literally thousands of lenses to choose from their modern DSLR offerings right the way back to legacy Nikon or Nikkor glass, even back to the pre D lens days. So if you've got the AIS AI lenses, they'll all work, albeit manually, on this camera. And one other thing is that the battery does seem to last forever. But image quality wise, I'm very, very happy. I'll put up the picture I took now of the lower Clingwyn waterfall back in 2013 I took this. And this still stands up today as, I think, one of the best waterfall pictures I've ever taken, end of. Now, today I use the camera primarily with my macro lens on it, and to that end it does produce really, really nice images. In fact, I'll pop this picture up now of some bluebells I took in my garden, and I'm growing some in a pot in my garden. I think this is one of the best flower pictures I've ever taken, and I'll put it up now for you to have a look at. And I actually made an A3 plus print of this image, so don't let the low megapixel or the seemingly low megapixel count put you off. 12 megapixels is more than enough for, you know, home printing up to A3 plus size, and probably beyond use. It's not all, you know, sunshine and roses though. The camera is old, it is showing its age, and it is slow and clunky in its operation, a bit like the Fujifilm X-E1 from last week. But this is even older, slower and clunkier than that. And it's not quite in the X-E1's sort of league when it comes to coolness either. I mean, which one of these would you rather, sorry, whip out in public? But all that aside, this really is an excellent tool to do a job. You can pick one up for so cheap, I reckon you could probably put together a reasonably good landscape kit with one of these cameras, something like a Tamron 10-24 or a Tokina 11-17, and something like a 55-200 lens for less than £500. And if you had that kit, you can make any landscape image you want. And probably all sorts of other types of images as well, but I'm coming at it from a landscape angle. If I could only have one of these cameras, I'd probably choose the Fujifilm, to be honest. I mean, I'm all in with mirrorless now. I prefer the mirrorless workflow. And this is a four-year-old more modern camera, and it feels more modern, even though it's quite old and slow in its operation. But to be honest, these are so cheap now, you haven't really got to make a choice. You can have both. You know, go on, make some room on your camera shelf, or like me, buy a bigger shelf and get both of them. I don't think you'll regret it, to be honest, for the money. And even if you did, you get your money back. I'm pretty certain of that. Right, that is it from Dexy and me for this week's video. Images to come at the end are all pretty well straight out of camera. The newer ones are, anyway. Straight out of camera, raw. Aside from some light cropping in certain circumstances. Okay, stay safe, stay well, look after yourselves, your loved ones, and your little pets. And be nice, be a nice person, and buy a nice camera. And Dexter and I will see you very, very soon. Probably on Saturday. Bye-bye.